I'm Mike Wald, and I lead the accessibility team here at the Web and Internet Science Group in ECS at the University of Southampton. Synote came out of some work I've been doing for quite a long time in collaboration with an organisation called the Liberated Learning Consortium, who worked with IBM on the use of speech recognition, initially for transcribing lectures for deaf students. The idea was speech recognition had come along, and wouldn't it be great to be able to use speech recognition live in classrooms to transcribe lectures? And we found that deaf students liked this, but we also found that dyslexic students liked it because they found it difficult to take notes. We found students, international students, loved it because quite often they couldn't understand what was being said. And then we found everybody loved it because getting a transcript of the recording meant that they could concentrate on what was being said, not scrabbling to take notes. But one of the problems is, if you had an hour's lecture, you didn't want to re-listen to the whole hour's lecture again. You wanted to be able to take bits of it. Also, if you were taking notes in the lecture, you wanted to match up the notes you took with replaying the bits of the recording. So what Synote was an attempt to actually do that. And the analogy I gave, because people found it very hard to understand why anyone should want to do this. There was a lot of talk at the time about lecture capture, and people were looking at systems that can record lectures. And my point was, well, if you just listen to a boring hour lecture, who wants to replay another boring hours of that lecture? The trouble was, most people didn't think of video that way. And the problem was, when students watch video, they went into movie mode. You know, they leant back, got the popcorn and the Coca-Cola out, and sort of said, come on, I want to be entertained. And so, trying to make people understand this, I used the analogy when I put the bid into Jisc of a textbook, and I said, if a textbook had no page numbers, no headings, no chapters, no index, no contents, nobody could use it as a textbook. It would be a storybook. And unfortunately, lecture capture of videos is exactly that. So what Synote was designed to do was allow you to bookmark parts of the recording, to search parts of the recording from the transcript. It would allow you to take notes and have them linked up to bits of the recording which you could replay. It also had the feature that you could replay the recording, just the bits you wanted, in any order, so reuse recordings. One of the provisos of the Jisc project funding was, we had to have users using it within 3 months. And it was the Users in Innovations program, and the idea was, you get users involved. So we had to have a very fast environment to build this. So we actually used Google Web Toolkit at the time. And basically, Synote has four panels. They're movable panels. It's got the video or audio player panel. It has a transcript player, transcript panel, and it has a note or bookmarking panel, and it's got an image or slide panel. And you can readjust these panels to take up the screen area. And basically, everything's synchronized with everything else. So if you click on a word in the transcript, the recording jumps to that point, the notes jump to that point, and the slides jump to that point. If you move the slides through and click on a slide, everything synchronizes. If you move the player, so everything is synchronized with everything else. When we developed it, we wanted to keep it as flexible as possible. And so we didn't have roles of students or lecturers. Basically, we had an owner role, and then you had permissions to make it annotatable, readable, shareable. We had the issue about storage of media, so, and also copyright. So what we decided to do was not store any of the actual media. So what you do is you put the URL of where you have the video stored It could be YouTube, it could be your own web space, it could be anywhere. So what Synote does is it replays the video, but doesn't store it in its own servers, and it just syncs up all the other information. So we only store the text and the timing points of the synchronization. And it's the same for the slide images, the images. We don't store those. And that meant, for the cost of the project, we could only afford a terabyte server. And I worked out we could hold the annotations and the transcripts and the notes for 6 million videos that way. Whereas to do that any other way, we would need a YouTube server farm. We initially tried to support every format and every browser. And to do that in the end, we had to have two players. We used Media Player and we used JW Player. And in 2008, we managed to support virtually all the video formats and all the browsers. Since that time, because of changes, that doesn't work anymore in all the browsers and all the formats. The problem is, again, is the sustainability. We brought another version out in 2009, and then we updated it in 2010 and made a version for the university, which used the LDAP logins of the university. Synote, originally, you set up your own username and password, and that was stored on Synote. The problem is we haven't been able to continue making sure that with changes of browsers, I mean, the problem with browsers are Google Chrome or Firefox, they suddenly update. You download the latest version, you don't know what the changes have been, and suddenly something doesn't work. And the players, again, have problems. So we've developed a new version of Synote, which has been used as part of some other Jisc projects. So we developed a version called Synote Researcher, which was part of a project called Aluar. And the idea of that was that researchers actually needed a tool for taking notes in terms of analyzing recordings, research recordings, and coding. And at the time, there really were no simple tools to use to do this. And it's fair enough if you're going to be a full-time researcher doing this every day of your life. But if you're a student or a PhD student or an undergraduate student or a MSc student, and you just want to analyze a recording for a project, to learn, you know, some of these very complex and also quite expensive professional tools was just overkill. So we developed Synote Researcher that would allow you to code recordings, analyze recordings. And then we got some funding to make a mobile version, because one of the problems was Synote was developed in 2008. And at the time, nobody was really using mobiles. And so the technology we used had problems. The players didn't run on mobiles. When you tried to run them on an iPhone or whatever, there was problems with running the players. So we developed Synote Mobile to be able to run on mobile platforms. So there's the original version of Synote, and then we have Synote Researcher and Synote Mobile, which are running on the new version of Synote platform. Synote originally, it was because we can hold 6 million, recording instances. The idea was, well, everybody could use it. The university wanted its own version, and so they have installed the code, and we helped them install it. A few other universities approached us, and we said, fine, it's open source project. Download it. We're happy to help you. Up to now, nobody else seems to have done that. I think partly because one of the points about Synote was it wasn't a lecture capture system. Our feeling was there were lots of ways to capture lectures. For example, PowerPoint can capture a lecture. And we actually developed a PowerPoint converter tool which allows you to use a narrated PowerPoint and load it into Synote. There's Camtasia, all the lecture capture tools, there's video. So our feeling was, it wasn't about lecture capture. There were enough lecture capture tools. You could replay any of this stuff through Synote and add annotations. The problem is most of the universities were more interested in lecture capture. So for example, a lot of universities are using things like Panopto which has note-taking tools on it. But for example, this university hasn't enabled the note-taking tool on Panopto because the feeling is, oh, that's too much for students. So I think part of the problem that people have had is they just are interested in the lecture capture, the pedagogy of actually what you can do with it and how it helps people learn hasn't really been entered into, because the people who've been in charge of the technology, you know, are not educationalists, they're the technologists. And I think that's been part of the issue. So Synote has won lots of awards. It won the Times Higher Education ICT Initiative Award. It won the International UNIS Award. It's won lots of awards. But it has been used, you know, but I think it's this issue about looking at the education and the pedagogy of why this thing helps. The other thing is, it was designed to be accessible. It was designed to help students with disabilities. But the way I got the funding, the project I got the funding through, was nothing to do with disability, because when I put bids in to get support for accessibility, the argument was, yeah, but the funding bid wasn't for accessibility. And so in the end, I turned it on its head and managed to get the funding by saying this would help everybody. Mm. Oh, by the way, it's accessible. Just go to synote.org and it's there, and anyone can use it.